Hi friends, this is Manoj Prabhakar from Smart Leaders IAS. In this session of editorial analysis, we will discuss the editorials that appeared on 9th of February. So the first editorial we are going to discuss is on development of science and technology in India. The editorial is titled as Big Discoveries Have Smaller Origins. So what was the necessity for the author to write such article now? See, the Economic Survey 2017-18, that is the recent edition of Economic Survey, it had dedicated a separate chapter for developing science and technology in India. So this is the first time in an Economic Survey a separate chapter being dedicated to science and technology. What the Economic Survey has spoken about, the major point is Economic Survey has called for doubling India's science and technology expenditure. At the present scenario, we are spending 1 lakh crore or 0.8% of our GDP towards science and technology. So the Economic Survey has proposed to double the expenditure, that is to 2 lakh crore at 1.6% of GDP. So will it be sufficient to reach a level reached by other advanced countries? The author says that even the government starts to double the income the very next day, will it be possible by doubling our expenditure to reach the levels of other scientifically advanced countries? The author does not feel so. He says that even if the government is increasing the expenditure the very next day after the announcement, it's going to be far lesser than the amount spent by other developed economies like China, Israel, Japan and US. They are already spending more than 2% of the GDP on research. The author is also lamenting that the focus of Indian science and technology is mainly on mega projects and not on smaller projects. So the author calls that small researches are bountiful. Only based on small researches, small level science projects, larger projects have come out from. So, it says that seminal innovations were result of scientists working in small-scale science projects at very tight budget. We all know the Higgs boson experiment conducted by CERN in France, and they are spending around $1 billion for the boson particle to identify the nature of boson particle. It had its humble origins in theoretical papers published by Peter Higgs and other scientists. Also, we all know the Google, which is now being called as Alphabet, which is part of Alphabet group of companies by Larry Page. Its present market value is somewhere around $100 billion, and it started as a small mathematical project funded by National Science Foundation at Stanford University. So just see how a small project, a small funding for a mathematical project developed into a larger enterprise. Also, we all know C.V. Raman, who invented a spectrometer. He initially worked on a spectrometer built in his laboratory, which cost around $200 that time. Now, the business for the market value of spectrometers are around $1.2 billion. Also, we all know Mr. Vikram Sarabhai, who is the teacher of Bharatratna APJ Abdul Kalam. He started experimenting with sounding rockets, smaller rockets, which led to the formation of ISRO. In India, the researchers are mainly funded by SERB, that is Science and Engineering Research Board. And this is a statutory authority under Government of India. So normally they receive funds from the central government through budgetary support, and out of that funds, they grant it for researchers. So how much they have received in the budget of 2018-19? Total scientific science and technology has received around 27,910 crores. Of that, SERB has been allotted with 900 crores, which is a meager 3%, which is not sufficient. And also in USA, comparing our stature with USA, in USA there is one particular institute called National Institutes of Health, which focuses on researches happening in health related activities. They have disbursed around $25 billion as research grants in 2017. This contributes to 36% of US non-defense research budget. This is a whopping amount. And see the contrast between the amount spent by both the countries. And also in UK, and another advanced economy in science, the Engineering and Physical Sciences Research Council, they spend around 10% of the research budget as grants, whereas India spends only around 3% towards research budget. See, what we are doing is, India is focusing mainly on mission mode projects. Say it Chandrayaan, say it Mangalyaan. We are focusing on mission mode projects, be it nuclear reactors. We are not focusing on smaller projects. All these larger projects, they need a supply chain. They need supply of talents, supply of human resources, also supply of innovation, cutting down the grants to smaller side projects or providing lower grants to science projects is going to cut down the pipeline of innovation and talent for higher projects. See, the author feels that there should be some competitive research grants for IITs, IISCRs and other universities. And a government has launched Prime Minister Research Fellowship. So anyone with undergraduate degree can apply for this Prime Minister Research Fellowship. In the Prime Minister's Research Fellowship program, the research fellows are granted substantial grants to motivate the youngsters to take up research as a profession. So this is a welcome step. And these kind of providing research grants, high and a good substantial amount of research grants, it's going to bring much talent into the research ecosystem. This will lead into, normally the research or research happening in universities are all mainly measured by three factors. Publications, that is the international papers they publish, and the patents they file, and on the innovations they do. So this will help, this improving grants for researchers is going to help in getting higher publishing, higher patents, and increasing the innovation potential, utilizing the innovation potential of India. And the economic survey has opted for investigator driven science research in India. So this is a welcome step. See, the author has entered in a note that smaller ideas of today, they can grow into a gargantuan enterprises of tomorrow. So it's a high time that India should focus on improving the research ecosystem in the country. The next article we are going to discuss was on Rohingya issue. The article is titled Disquieting Silence. We all know Rohingyas. Rohingyas are predominantly Muslim minority people of Myanmar. They are Myanmar. For the past 2 or 3 years, they are facing a crisis, because of which more than 6,50,000 members have fled to Bangladesh as refugees. And many of the United Nations organizations executives have termed it to be an hallmark of genocide. And UN High Commissioner for Human Rights has called it to be an textbook example of ethnic cleansing. So we all know genocide. What is a genocide? Genocide is, another example of genocide can be massacre of Jews by Hitler during World War II. So the UN Special Envoy on Human Rights feels that there is another kind of genocide happening in Myanmar. See, Myanmar was part of India till 1935. We all know the basics of history. So India, apart from that, India has also got connectivity route through Myanmar to India's northeast states. So India has some moral obligation to work on it. But India has not done anything except providing 500 tons of food and other aids. And India has also inked an agreement to develop normalcy, to bring in normalcy in Rakhine state. This is all paperwork, no proper work on the ground. Apart from this, India infamously decided to send 40,000 Rohingyas back to Myanmar, citing that India has not signed the 1951 Convention of Refugees. I have provided here an image in this slide. The image has a map of Myanmar, Bangladesh and India. See the location of Rakhine State. Rakhine State is given in orange here. And the Sitwe Port is an important location for India's Kaladan multimodal project. And from Kolkata through Sitwe Port, and through Sitwe Port, we can easily reach northeastern part of India. So this is strategically and economically important for India. By opting out of providing a possible solution for Rohingya crisis, have India has lost its way in bringing in peace in the region. Not only Myanmar has also not taken any affirmative steps to rehabilitate Rohingyas. And the Myanmar army still discriminates Rohingyas, calling them Bengalis, and they are also termed as non-natives. Myanmar is a multi-ethnic country. The Burmans are majority, and Buddhism is the majority religion. Rohingyas being Muslims, and they belong to a different ethnic group, they are minority and they are being ill-treated in their country. And they are not given any citizenship right. Basic citizenship right is also, they live without citizenship in their home country. This is pathetic. And China has taken initiative. See, India's foreign policy has always been very high on vocals. Even Shashi Tharoor in his book Pax Indica has spoken about it. What is this all about? Initially, India proposes many things, and after that, we don't undertake much action afterwards. So we create a vacuum. Then the China or other country comes in and fills a vacuum. They build a strategic relationship with that country, and thus goes India's soft power. The better example is Chabahar. Chabahar was proposed in 2003, but only now they have opened the Chabahar port. See, it was around some 14 years. The project was just slow, moving in a very snail pace. India has to work on these aspects. This initiative by China has brought Myanmar and Bangladesh together. See how strategically Bangladesh and Myanmar are located. China getting inroads into Myanmar, supporting the cause of Bangladesh, is going to pull down our importance in the region. The author feels that India should take effective leadership role in bringing down the violence in Rakhine State, not only on humanitarian grounds, at least for the sake of strategic and economic reasons. The next editorial was on NABARD Act. The NABARD Act was amended recently, and the title of the article is A Boost to Rural Entrepreneurship. So we all know NABARD is National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development. What is the history of NABARD? NABARD was formed by the recommendation of Sivaraman Committee. Sivaraman was an ex-Planning Commission member. Based on his recommendation, NABARD was formed. The agricultural credit function was earlier done by RBI. It had a separate division, and with that division, RBI was undertaking agricultural credit. And the refinancing function was done by ARDC, Agriculture Refinance and Development Corporation. These both were government organizations. So when was NABARD created? NABARD Act was passed on 1981. NABARD was formed on 1982 with the initial capital of 100 crore. And RBI had minority stake of 0.4% in NABARD, and the total government had 51% stake. Of that, 0.4 is RBI and the remaining was with central government. Apart from handling aspects of agricultural credit, rural development and refinancing agri credits, NABARD is also the nodal agency for financing climate change projects in India. What was NABARD Amendment Bill 2017 was all about? The bill has four important provisions. The first provision is increasing the capital of NABARD, infusion of capital, the second is transfer of RBI share. We all know that RBI has a 0.4% of share, and it should be transferred to central government. Also, introducing the terms of MSME Act 2006 into NABARD Act. And the changes were also made to make NABARD to be compliant with Companies Act 2013. Increase in capital. Initially, as we saw earlier, NABARD was started with 100 crore capital. Later, the capital was increased as paid up capital, and the paid up capital was around 5,000, And now, since NABARD is involving in many projects, NABARD is involving in many areas, the government wanted to improve the capital of NABARD. So, the capital, the bill has a provision to increase the capital more than rupees 30,000 crore. Also, RBI, the banking regulator, having a stake, even a minority stake, in agricultural development related organization, there was some kind of conflict of interest. So the government thought so, and the RBI share was transferred to government. In lieu of the purchase of share, government has paid 20 crore rupees. Also, consistency with Companies Act. Companies Act, the new provisions in the bill makes the NABARD to be complying with Companies Act 2013 by changing definition of, by introducing definition of a government company and qualification of auditors. And what was the aspect related with MSME? As we discussed earlier, since NABARD is also involved in rural development projects, what was the provision related to micro, small and medium enterprises? See, the MSME sector plays a crucial role in improving the livelihood of rural area. So, even NABARD has, the interest of both these NABARD and MSME, they both overlap in rural areas are concerned. So, the government thought that the definition of micro, small and medium sector in the parent act of NABARD, so the government has extended the definition of micro, small, medium enterprises in NABARD to the definition as given in MSME Act 2006. Also, the bill has extended the NABARD financing to enterprises with NABARD. See, normally NABARD does financing and refinancing. So, for micro, small, medium enterprises with investment of 10 crore, up to 10 crore in manufacturing, NABARD can extend credit now. Also, for MSME industries involved in services sector, the whose investments are up to rupees 5 crores, NABARD can extend credit assistance. The present amendment bill is an welcome move because developing rural population or developing agriculture, they need entrepreneurs, one who knows technology, one who has the mindset to bite the bullet, that is to take the risk. So providing NABARD with new provisions is going to help the cause of entrepreneurs, and as the title of these articles suggests, it is really a boost to rural entrepreneurship.